Hello everyone, if you're out there, you're one of the many people who's made a request. I'm sorry this video is not going to be one of the requested topics. Some of the requests I've gotten need a little bit of research just so I can do them justice, but they're coming. Now, what I want to talk about today is the simple concept of motivation. And I don't think we don't think about it enough, but it really drives our lives and everything we do every day. And when I say motivation, I mean, why do we do the things we do? So, to engage with this topic, let's think about something. Let's say that scientists come out tomorrow and say, hey, we could genetically modify all of our children in the next generation, and they'll all be, you know, 30 IQ points smarter. Okay, well, there'd be a lot of people who'd be opposed to that because they'd be afraid of what might happen. What if this all goes wrong? Okay, but what if instead of that, let's imagine an alternative scenario where the scientist comes and he says, I've just discovered this neurotoxin that keeps falling from space, and it's going to make the next generation 30 IQ points dumber, and it's been making us dumber every generation. And if you do this treatment that I came up with, then it'll stop the process, and they'll be right where we are. Okay, so everyone will probably support that. You'd be massive support. So in other words, this is called the status quo bias, and I borrowed this example from Sam Harris, but it's just a good lead-in for what we're going to talk about, which I definitely didn't borrow from him. But why do we do the things we do? Are we doing the things we do to maintain the way things are? Or are we doing the things that we do because there's some good thing that we want to accomplish or achieve or have that we don't already have? In other words, are we looking to what could be? Or are we looking to the way things are? Now, in the example I gave, both of those, you know, could be seen either way. You know what I mean? Like, you know, you could be trying to accomplish a good thing, and the good thing is keeping things the way they are, and defending the way things are from all the things that are trying to corrupt it. So in other words, protecting and maintaining is the good thing that you want to accomplish. But I want to think more fundamentally than that. Okay, so what I mean is, why do we do the things we do? Okay? And so the problems we run into are twofold, okay? Because if we go out every day and we say, hey, there's good things and I could accomplish them. All right? The first problem we run into, it really involves your own life as you as a person. Because all of us have made mistakes. We've all failed. We all have failures. And because of that, then we can never be as good as we originally set out to be, if that makes sense. So you start out your life and you say, okay, life is going to be awesome. I'm going to accomplish this, 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 and this, and I'm going to have this great life. And then you blow it. You don't do whatever it is you want to do. I don't remember the name of the song, but there was a song that was kind of about this, and it's a common life experience, failure. But as you age, your failures become bigger because you just have more freedom as an adult. When you're a kid, you can mess up really bad, and your parents kind of come in, and they've kind of got you contained in a box, and you can only mess up so much in that box. It's sort of your playpen that is childhood. As you get older, you get more freedom and more responsibility and more ability and more capability to mess up more and more things. And what happens is that the way the song put it, I think it was a country song actually, and this is back when I had cable, and the song just went, you flip through the channels and you see, I've had my moments, and that was the way the song went. I don't remember the song exactly, but basically it had the gist of what I'm talking about, that this person had failed tremendously and really messed up something in his life, and he was looking through pictures of the good things that he's done. He's had his moments where he did it right. And I think it had him on the bridge, like he was going to jump off a bridge and perhaps commit suicide. But then he was looking back over his accomplishments and saying, my life isn't that bad. And that was going to get him through it. Okay. So, let's think about that. Ultimately, every failure means that you are not as good of a person as you could have been. So, if your purpose in life is to be awesome and be great and do great things, then you will never have as great of a thing to live for as it could have been, since you have made this failure. Every young person, they say, you know, when I get out there, when I get on my own, I'm going to do awesome. Well, who says they're going to blow it, right? Their own version of awesome, but they all have it. Don't work out, does it? You hate your parents because you think they're terrible people when you're a teenager, and then when you become an adult, you make your own mistakes, and you realize your parents are kind of just normal people like you, and they're actually doing pretty well. And then what if you blow it really, really bad, and it's just hard for you mentally to even live with yourself, because it's like you're going to build a house, and you had this idea of this great, awesome house, but then you keep having to cut parts out of it until eventually you're left with like a lean-to, you know, or something, or a little stick shelter, you know. So you had this mansion that you were going to build of these awesome things in this life of awesomeness, and failure after failure after failure after failure after failure after failure. Okay? Now, one way sometimes people cope with it is they just pretend that they haven't failed. And that gets really dangerous. That's scary. Let me offer an alternative that maybe brings hope to the situation. What if we do the good things we do because of a good thing that already exists? The Bible says when Jesus is asked, you know, what's the greatest commandment, he quotes from Deuteronomy. Now, in Deuteronomy, Deuteros Namas means second law, okay? So, like, you have the law that is given in the Old Testament, and then the book of Deuteronomy is like a review book where they go over it again and they kind of give interpretation a little bit. So, the interpretation that Deuteronomy gives of the first commandment of the all 630 commandments, you know, they're starting with the top 10, and then I think it's 630. But I don't have them all memorized, give me a break. The first one is love the Lord your God. Now, it doesn't just say love God. And I think that's the way most people would like for it to read. They don't say that's the way they would like for it to read, but that's the way most people would like for it to read. They like it to be just love God, or love God first is the way they say it, and then love your friends and family second. That's not what it says. That is not what it says. It says love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. In other words, with everything. Okay, the problem is, that means there's no room left for you to love anyone else. You don't have anything left to love anyone else with, do you? You just love God, and God alone. And we say, well, am I not supposed to love other people? Isn't it good to love other people? And I want you to think about this. The way most people set this up in life and their ultimate life motivations, at least if they are claiming themselves to be Bible believing Christians, is they'll say, you know, love God first, he's top priority, second priority would be like my family, and then my friends, you know, and it goes on down the list. Okay? And so imagine, like, it's like this, and here's one, and here's the other, and here's the other, and here's the other. Okay, and we say, we'll say maybe this one's God, okay, and your family and your friends. All right, now my fingers don't really work because this one would be down a notch. I guess I could do it like this. Yeah. All right, so down a notch, you got it. Okay, now what happens if, you know, I guess you lose your religion and you don't believe in God anymore? And all the other ones just move up a notch. In other words, your value for these things, they were really, like, independent. They're all independent. You know what I mean? Like, if I take out my family, then the other two move up a notch. If I take out my friends, whatever's down there moves up a notch. Which, yeah, it happens for some people, right? They let go of their family, and I let go of their friends, and they make new friends, and, you know, and that kind, you get the idea. Okay. Let's think of it in a different way. All right, so I'll use my hand again. All right. Let's say that my hand and arm is God, and it's the only thing, the one thing, the only thing that I care about. Okay? And then I love my family, my friends, my whatever, my other things, not separately from God, but connected to God. In other words, because God loves them, because of God, that's why I love them. So what that means is if you take God out of the picture, everything's gone. That God and God alone defined what you thought about everything. And so you, in other words, you love only God. Interesting stuff flows from that. But let's go back to what we were talking about. What that means is, you know, we don't just love, you know, our family and our friends, you know. We value things that we think are good. Achievements, whatever achievement it is. You want to win a baseball game by hitting a home run. You want to write a new song that's the best song ever. You want to get more work done and make, you know, people impressed with how much work you can do. You want to, I don't know, invent something, create something, clean your house better, whatever it is, clean your body better, get in better shape, you know, do something for someone. You know, it's not just that you love people, but your love for people gets complicated because there's so many ways to express love and things you can and cannot do for people. There's so much. I got to get this done and I got to get that done. Okay. So what I'm saying is, if the Bible's correct, then we love only God. And that means that we do those good things because of the good thing that already exists. In other words, those things you want to do, that love for other people, remember, they're not good independent of themselves. They're only good because of God. Take God out of the picture, you have no reason for doing any of them. Showing love or kindness or doing any good thing ever, any great achievement ever. You understand? So, what we're saying is, instead of looking at life and saying, hey, I need to go accomplish this and I need to go accomplish that, we go out and we do what we do because of the good thing that already exists, which is God. You know what the cool thing about that is? A lot of things. First of all, no matter how many times you fail, your reason for doing the things you do has been completely unchanged because it's God. God is the reason why I do this good thing for you. God is the reason why I want to accomplish this. God is the reason why I do that. My good thing, my treasure, is not what I will gain or create or build, but is what already exists and is indestructible. And so, even if it's your life and you say, I want to live this life of awesomeness, and then you fail and 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 you fail, your reason for getting out of the bed and doing good things has not changed one little bit. It's changed as much as God has changed. You understand what I'm saying? So there's further ramifications. Because, I think most people don't realize the amount of stress that is taken off their back by simply having your job and your work hours figured out for you. And if you're like me, and like a lot of people, where you have more freedom in your schedule, maybe someone on salary, even if you're retired, I think it's, a lot of times people retire and they become more busy, right? Your boss makes a schedule for you and he figures out your job for the day. That is a job to do that. That is a task to do that. And to say, okay, we're going to get this done and we're going to get this done. And because there's always things that you're giving up on every day, every single day. And I think a lot of people don't realize how easy they have it because they have a schedule. I remember when I first started working for myself, I really got aggravated when people would call me. He's like, "Well, when you get off? Because I want to go do this. What time do you get off? What time do you get off Saturday?" Well, there is no such thing. It's all created in my head by what I decide. And like, everyone thinks, well, that means that you can do what I want you to do for me. Because you're in charge and I'm talking to the boss, and the boss is going to do what I want. And the problem is that the boss has to decide what really needs to be done and what doesn't, and the boss has to be the bad guy all the time. So then I have to be the bad guy all the time with my life, with my time, because for me, there's I thought of someone come in, even though no one lives here. For me, there's never a day where there's not someone who's complaining that I'm not somewhere else. So the point is every single day I get confronted with what I have failed to accomplish. Every day, everywhere I look, I see, because I mow lawns all over my town and my area, and I can just drive around town and just see lawns that, need this done and need that done, and boom, 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 the calls keep coming in. In the last month, five people, I think, knew, "When are you going to get to this?" Some customers call me and want to know when I'm going to get to something for another customer who hasn't even called me. "And when are you going to get to this? When are you going to get to that? When are you going to get to this? When are you going to get to that?" And for my business, it's interesting, because there's no line. Like, if you go in McDonald's or something like that, and if they're really backed up with customers, you see a long line, you see a parking lot full of cars, and you say, "Oh, they're busy right now." No one sees that with me. I see that, and everyone thinks I'm lying, and that I could get it all done, and they have no idea that other people exist. And that's just the way it goes. Everyone thinks they're my only customer and like their one neighbor, and I have a lot of people who think I should really, when I come to their house, I should just stay at their house all day until everything that they want is done, because other people don't matter. And I have to be the bad guy for the sake of these other people. So everyone thinks I'm not as busy as I really am. They just see me driving around doing stuff. But I've got other projects, and you've probably got other projects with your free time, with your days off, with whatever it is that, like, I need to get this done, and this needs to be being accomplished, and when am I going to get to this? And I want to do better at taking care of this. And that is going just completely ignored. What am I doing there? And when am I going to get to this thing that I said a long time ago that I really wanted to do, but it's like so hard, and can I do it? Can I do it? Here's the problem. We are completely incapable of ever knowing a good measurement of what we're really capable of. And that's one of the things I live by. You never know what you can really do. And on one end, that's it motivates you, and it encourages you, because, hey, I can do it. Put my mind to it and I can do anything. But there's a negative side to that, because that means that no matter what you do, you could have done more. You could have accomplished more. And history has shown, especially in the last 100 years, or maybe a little longer, 150 years, that yeah, there's we figured out ways to do things that we thought were impossible before. as humanity, as a race, people come up with new and better ways of doing stuff all the time. I have my own TV channel. When I was a teenager, I remember watching MTV, and they had this commercial, and there was a cat, and the guy was holding a little hoop for like the little kitten, and it just goes, it's just boring video, it just goes through the hoop, through the hoop. But I wouldn't have called it a video back then, I would have just called it a commercial. The use of the word videos is a new thing today. And I said through the hoop. It was a commercial, through the hoop. And then it just went, in the future, everyone will have their own TV station. And I thought to myself, I was like, that's the dumbest thing ever. Like, that'll never happen. That's what I thought. That'll never happen. Because there'd be too many numbers. And I thought you'd never be able to find anything. And, well, we don't use, like, numbers, like, on TV. You know, this is channel 121. We don't do that for YouTube and for the internet, right? But it is hard to find. You can't watch them all. You can't watch everything. And that is the reality. And on top of all of that, stupid cat videos are really popular. So I was so wrong. But that's the reality is, why didn't I invent this, what you see before you in 1997? Well, Ben, you couldn't have pulled that off. That's too much for you. Is it really? Is it really? I could have done something. And then you have these people, Bill Gates, you know, fresh out of high school, and he, you know, started a company that today he has $90 billion, took over the world. But, I mean, they were just working hard, creating software for computers, creating chips that went in computers, doing this stuff. And we see these stories of these people, we get motivated, and we're like, man, I'm going to pull off this. Maybe for you it's a sports hero. You know, and you, this guy in the Hall of Fame, you know, or her, and like, they just dominated. They trained every day, you know? They trained every day. And they got super good. I remember, I used to live in an apartment at a college, and the guy who lived under me, he went to the NBA the next year, but I remember thinking, like, who is this guy? I didn't know he played for the team. He was just some tall dude that lived down below me. And like, I'd hear him come home and just dribble. Just dribble. And I kept doing my homework. And I'm thinking, like, why doesn't he have any homework? And who does he think he is? I thought that to myself. Like, who does he think he is? He's not going anywhere with all that dribbling. Okay, he got MVP a couple years later. So what do I know? I used to get really upset because he didn't seem in a hurry ever. He always seemed tired and just super relaxed. I didn't know he'd been practicing all day. And his homework probably was the dribbling. He didn't finish his college career. It was his second year of college. He's out. Went to the game finally and saw him like jumping over people. You know, so he was training. He was getting really good at basketball. You could be better at basketball. You could. You could, you know, find a little time to shoot a few, you know, free throws. You could be a little better at basketball. Next time you play, you might be like, yeah, maybe I did a little better. You could be a little better at just about anything and everything. You could be a little better with computers. You could be a little better with, I don't know, your hair, with vacuuming your house. Make sure that you have a clean and sanitary environment that in which you live, you know. You could be a little better at taking care of your car. I think everyone feels like that. Their car isn't taken care of quite right. You could be a little better at managing your finances. You know, what are the things you waste money on? You do a little better. Gotta do a little better. You do a little better. Here's the problem. As we probably rambled too long, and this is a boring topic anyway, except to me and, I don't know, maybe somebody watching. Here's the thing. No matter what you do, you could always do better. And you know it. Always. Every day, every minute of every single day. The problem with that is that if you could do better, then it's better that you do better. So you're always a failure. Always. You're permanently a total failure. You see what I'm saying? So, no matter how much you accomplish, you never know what you're capable of. Some people do go around saying, oh, you know, I'm just not that smart, or, you know, they just did their job that someone else told them to do. There's something more you could have done. Even if you work in a grocery store, you could have picked up one more piece of trash off the ground. It made that store look a little better. Right? And even when the time to clock out comes, you could have done a little better. And so, you know, what are we going to do? We're just going to ignore it. Until we make a big failure, and then we don't know what we're living for anymore. What were we living for? Some image of our own personal awesomeness? That whenever we fail, we just pretended that didn't happen? If God is the reason why you do what you do, then the good thing you're trying to accomplish is not on the table. You're doing what you do because of the good thing that already exists. And this is the twist I want you to understand. We don't do good things because of the long list of good things that we could accomplish. Because if that's the case, then we will forever be a failure. And our very motivation in life to do good things will forever leave us with a hole in here. Every day, all day. Wake up in the middle of the night, you might remember it. See what I'm saying? A hole. It's a God-shaped hole. I know you've heard this before. Only God can fill that hole. If God is the good thing, then you do everything you do because of the good thing that already exists. But no matter how many times you fail, your reason for getting up and going at it again hasn't been affected in the least. Because it's not the good that you could accomplish that you want to do. It's the good thing that already exists. That's why you do everything you do. Do you think God's impressed with any of our accomplishments? I think he looks back and he says, wow, that house you built is really fantastic. I just don't know how you pulled it off. You know, good job for you. You know, we ignore God. And it's to our own peril. It's to our own mental and psychological peril. Because if we ignore God, then we become all that there is and all that matters. That's very dangerous. You know, now I'm not talking about narcissism. Narcissism is when you have an inflated sense of self. What I'm talking about is, as humanity, if we think we're all that there is, then the greatest thing there is us. And that's kind of a bummer, isn't it? A letdown. Really? That's it? You know, there was this movie, it's called, More Than Dreams? Not More Than Dreams. I don't know, it's got Robin Williams in it, back when he was living. And it's sort of a Buddhist ish, not really Buddhism, a spin on heaven, where heaven is just a place where you, whatever you dream becomes a reality. And I remember watching the movie and thinking, how sad is that? Don't I want to see something more than what I dream up? Isn't it boring, just my own thoughts? I want to hear or see or experience something that's beyond me. Yeah? And there is that. And there's that fear. You know, if there is no God, then it's just us. Who knows what might happen that we can't prevent bad stuff from happening and take away what little good things we have. What are we going to do? Well, we'll get desperate and we'll begin to create new laws and elect new leaders who violate everyone's freedom to keep you safe. Okay? Worse, when we ignore God, we start to set up levels. Well, this person's smarter, so they're more important, and they're, you know, they're at this level. And this person's from the poor neighborhood, and you know, they're this job is for them. This guy, he's the noble, nobility. He runs things. The serf down here. And here's you, the dummy, to make everyone laugh, and then we kill you for a good laugh. You slave person, whatever. You get the idea. If God's in the picture, then where does he fit? Well, would he be like, he'd be higher than the best person, right? So here's the best, here's like the second best person, here's the best person. And they're this far apart. Well, how far higher is God? Oh, he's way up there. So, well, how far high is he? He's so far up that if you were to zoom out far enough to see him on the scale at the same time that you see you, then like all of us, the differences between us, we get smaller and smaller and smaller as we zoom out till there's no difference. And think about how God sees our accomplishments. Is he impressed with any of them? Are you impressed with ants building an anthill, with birds building a nest? Oh, what a nest. I couldn't stack those twigs. No, no, no. Oh, you piled up that dirt with little tunnels in it. Rain's just going to fall and go all in there. Doesn't even have a roof on it. Much less air conditioning. Now, he's got plumbing, though, doesn't it? But it won't be clean water, will it? You see what I'm saying? God is not impressed. So, this is a key point for us to understand. There is a God who is greater than we can possibly imagine. Greater than anything we can accomplish. There is a good thing that already exists. And so, the good things that we don't do because we're worried about what might happen. Because we're worried about making sure a bunch of long lists of good things happen, but because there is already a good thing. And then nothing we do, nothing we fail to do, nothing anyone does, nothing that ever happens, changes our motivation. And how big is our motivation? How incredible is our motivation? It couldn't be bigger. It couldn't be more incredible. You know, think about it this way. When you were a kid, we all were kids, and we've all seen kids. You know, I'm talking like 3, 4, maybe 5. And your parents, one of your parents, maybe your grandparent, some adult, but probably your parents, your mom or your dad, ask you to help them with something. You were blown away. How awesome that was. You're so excited. Help fix supper or fix this or do that. Man, this is awesome. Fast forward through time, you're 15, 16. Your parent doesn't ask for your help. Well, they do ask for your help, but they ask you just to go get it done to help them. You're, oh, I gotta do this. Oh, I got so much to do already. Ah, oh, I can't watch my show. Ah. Teenager. See what I'm saying? So, what happened? Why were you so excited before? Well, part of it was just the fact that this stuff was new to you, and the whole world was new to you. But there's another reason. Why weren't you afraid before? Why weren't you overwhelmed with the job? I mean, when you're 3, and your parent asks for your help, are you actually helping with anything? But here's the thing. Your parent, you're getting to do something with them, and you think that person is awesome. You see what I'm saying? You're excited.